With a backdrop of the New York skyline, the Meadowlands of New Jersey hosts the great sporting events of the age. Today, it's the high-speed horsepower of the Indy cars. Years ago, the Indy cars began their run in the New York area. Then, it was Mario Andretti on the pole. He led throughout the race, facing fuel starvation at the end of the run, but came home as the winner of the first run at the Meadowlands. Then, 2 years ago, it was Al Unser Jr. locked in a points fight with his father for the national championship. Al Unser drove steadily throughout the run and came home the winner of the second Meadowlands event. Last year, it was Bobby Rahal trying to hold off the aggressive Danny Sullivan, former New York cab driver. Sullivan brushed Rahal aside and won. Today, on Sports World, the Indy cars are back again at the Meadowlands. Mario Andretti was CART's first winner of the year through the streets of Long Beach. But then, at Milwaukee, 4 weeks ago, Andretti slammed the wall hard when the wing came off of his car. As a result, he drives today still very sore from that impact. Then Bobby Rahal became a winner just 2 weeks ago at Portland, winning the road race there. And Michael Andretti won the Milwaukee race, putting his name in the list of CART winners. And Roberto Guerrero won the race at Phoenix, his first IndyCar win. So today, from New Jersey, Chevrolet presents the Meadowlands Indy. It's a magnificent afternoon in the New York area. About 6 miles away across the Hudson River, the skyline of downtown Manhattan, crisp and clear today because rains yesterday washed the air clear. It's a wonderful temperature and a great day for racing. But we're at the Meadowlands Sports Complex of New Jersey, where the Giants Stadium stands, home to the reigning Super Bowl champions. But it's not football today. Today, it's the Indy cars of CART. Well, good afternoon. I'm Paul Page, and we're looking forward to a magnificent run. With me is three-time world champion Jackie Stewart. Jackie, what is interesting about the grid here today is that the first four cars represent the four winners of CART this year.
Yes, well, in pole position is the man that I would call my favorite for the race. That's Mario Andretti. If you consider his experience, his knowledge, his maturity, he knows how to win on road racing. It's his speciality. Bobby Rahal, I've never thought to be quite as strong on road courses as he is on ovals. Michael Andretti, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, wants to show Daddy that he can win on the same racetrack. Well, it may not be his today, but who knows? Roberto Guerrero, however, on the other hand, I think is capable of winning here. Very aggressive, terribly hungry, wants to prove something, has had mechanical unreliability so far this year to a large extent. He could do it.
But Roberto Guerrero has been a key player in every race this season. The last two, he was leading when he suffered mechanical failure. That they may have solved today.
Well, they've got a fuel management system in his car and Michael Andretti's car. That could prove to be a big thing. It'll give them better pickup, better fuel consumption. It is just what it says, fuel management. It controls the flow, it gives better acceleration, and it could help that reliability factor.
Well, the pulse begins to quicken now because we're only a few minutes away from the roar of the engines as the Indy cars are ready to run at the Meadowlands.
Gentlemen, start your engines. Okay.
And here at the New Jersey Meadowlands, the roar of nearly 20,000 horsepower begins to build. We are ready to go racing once again. 100 laps lie ahead to determine who will be the fourth man to win at the Meadowlands. Mario Andretti sits ready. The tachometer is just lazily coming up as the engines come up to temperatures. There's Danny Sullivan, his crew still hovering over him, making sure that he is tightly strapped in and ready to go. Mario Andretti will start this race on the pole. He is in position, ready to roll out. Roberto Guerrero, quite a story this day. A man who may see his second IndyCar victory. Up and down the field, the crews have indicated that their cars are indeed ready to go. As Roberto Guerrero and his crew now watch. There is Michael Andretti, and he is ready to go. But on the front row, the fastest man is Mario Andretti. How will he win this race?
I feel it's very important to just get into an early rhythm. This is that type of a course. And because as you get into this so-called rhythm, it seems like you will not make mistakes. And you begin to drive quick but very diligently, and that's the way it is here. And I think it's worked for me before, and I feel this is the key.
So the great Mario Andretti feels that pacing your way to victory is the key to winning at the Meadowlands. He will start this race from the pole. He, of course, is the first winner of an IndyCar race at the Meadowlands. The outside of the front row is Bobby Rahal, who comes off a win just 2 weeks ago at Portland and is further along in the points than he has ever been. In the second row is Michael Andretti, the winner at the Milwaukee Mile, and he is looking for his second victory of the season. Alongside Roberto Guerrero, who won his first IndyCar race at Phoenix this year, now looking for his second win. The third row on the inside, two-time world driving champion Emerson Fittipaldi. And alongside him is Jeff Brabham, who has never won an IndyCar race. Could this be the day? The fourth row on the inside is Al Unser Jr., the winner here from 1985. The outside, Danny Sullivan. He is the defending champion at the Meadowlands. The fifth row on the inside is Kevin Cogan with one IndyCar win to his credit. He's looking for number two. And alongside is Rick Mears, hoping that his PC16 Chevrolet will bring him to victory. The sixth row on the inside is Jose Legarza, who has never won an IndyCar race. Alongside is Ari Leyendyk, another man looking for his first IndyCar win. The seventh row to the inside is Scott Brayton, a man who also looks for his first IndyCar victory. But alongside him, a longtime veteran, Tom Sneba, with 13 IndyCar wins to his credit. The eighth row to the inside is Johnny Rutherford, the defending champion from the Michigan 500. And a rookie sits to the outside of the eighth row, Fabricio Barbaza, looking for perhaps Rookie of the Year honors in kart. And as we take a look at the rest of the field over Mark Landretti's right shoulder, we have a wonderful mix here today. We have six different Holas, 18 Marches, two Penske PC16s, Chevrolet racing engines, the Cosworth racing engines, and four rookies will be among the 26 starters in the 13 rows here at the Meadowlands. So we're set to go. The lineup looks great. And we are ready to go racing with all engines started running and all cars on the course. One very interesting new piece of equipment on some of these cars. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Well, Paul, here is the latest wave in this ever-increasing sophistication that's been brought to IndyCars that Jackie touched on a few moments ago. This is the actual brain of the electronic fuel management system that's been designed to improve the Cosworth racing engine. It's being used for the very first time here today at the Meadowlands. It can be found in the right side pod of the cars driven by Michael Andretti, Roberto Guerrero, and Al Unser Jr. Now, this is a $25,000 package. It's been tested extensively by these teams, but today marks the first time it's ever been tested under racing conditions. As Jackie mentioned, it electronically monitors the engine. It provides fuel for maximum efficiency. It sees to it that the engine gets precisely the amount of fuel it needs at any given moment. Not too much, not too little. And these drivers are hoping today it will give them the edge to victory here at the Meadowlands. Paul?
Thank you, Gary. One man is especially hot here today. He is the defending champion, Bobby Rahal, sitting in the front row. And Bruce Jenner is standing by with a report on Bobby Rahal.
Thank you, Paul. You did mention that Bobby Rahal is having a very good year up to this, and you're right. Last year, he came to this race 28 points and went on to win the national championship. This year, he already has 53 points, and he did not get a finish at Indianapolis or at Long Beach. So he's way ahead of himself, and obviously, he's shown that his car can run here. He's in the front row right with Mario Andretti. But last year, you remember in the race that it was a great race between Rahal and Danny Sullivan. In fact, Sullivan bumped him to get the lead and wound up going on to win the race. This year, this is Rahal's pit, and as we move just right over here, here's Danny Sullivan's pit. So I think I'm just going to park myself right here. It should be a great race, Paul.
Thank you, Bruce Jenner. 100 laps, 168 miles, just a tick over that. A complex, very challenging circuit at the Meadowlands, and Jackie Stewart is here to describe it for you.
Well, you're looking over the shoulder Thank you, Paul. This Meadowlands track is dominated by the Giant Stadium and the Brendan Byrne Arena. The track is 1.682 miles around. It's very tight, leaving little or no opportunity to pass. The average speed, incidentally, in qualifying was 99.108 miles an hour. But they do get up to speeds of about 165 on what they call the straight, which is even then a curve. A lot of changing surfaces around here. There are six left-handers and five right-handers, 11 turns in total, a real tester.
So as we look over the right-hand shoulder of Al Unser, as he is on the circuit, Al Unser Jr., 76 degrees, very, very comfortable here to get today. No threat of rain, though we had rain here yesterday. That cleared the sky, and we're ready to go. Jackie, the indications are, because this course is so difficult, it will be very tough on the cars.
I think the most important element of it is the transmission itself. You can have universal joints, you can have CVs, you can have splines that can split. All of those things depend on how often the gear shift is used and how much is put onto those rear wheels. Because of the changing surface, the coefficients are different in that friction factor, and you can have a lot of transmission failures. It certainly has been a tough racetrack here in years gone past with regards to finishers. You see these little curbs there, the drivers have got to stay off them. The barriers themselves are very close to the racetrack. It's like a Monaco in Grand Prix racing. It's a street race in the full sense. The slightest error of judgment can cause a lot of trouble, but they've got to be quiet on transmission.
As you can see, as these cars work their way around, some places very narrow, only 31 feet wide as 50, as we are on the pace lap. And they're coming through the final set of turns. The PPG pace car brings them down to the line, the front row. Mario Andretti and the defending national champion, Bobby Rahal. They watch Nick Fenoro, the starter, who has the green flag. He says, no start, no start here. He did not like the alignment of that field. It looked good to the front row, but Nick Fenoro says, no, we will not go racing here at the Meadowlands. So now one lap going around, and they will realign themselves.
Well, I think the field was just a little strung out. It seemed to me that at the back end of the grid, it was rather open, and I think perhaps the starter decided that that was his prudent way of saying close up a little bit, and that might have saved trouble. Now we're looking over the shoulder of Mr. Andretti. You can see the car. That, in fact, seems to be the car of Al Unser Jr. at the present time. Al Unser Jr., we've got an on-car camera there in his car, as we do have in Michael Andretti's. You'll be able to see the steering wheel kick back on the driver quite a lot. It is a bumpy racetrack, and you can see the difference in surface.
Now, Mario Andretti was really ready for that start, though. He jumped right out there as soon as he thought it was going to go.
Well, he's concerned about what happens going into the first turn, and particularly the slow left-hander, as we now look over the shoulder of Michael Andretti. And, of course, a big traffic jam could take place, particularly at the first second-gear corner, which is designated as turn two.
Michael Andretti from the second row on our NBC kart cam. Now, this lap does count, and that is because there is an allocation of fuel, only so much, and they can't just arbitrarily stick laps into the race. So this is really lap number one, though we are not yet racing. We're looking overhead down on the Meadowlands Sports Complex.
Which helps, incidentally, with fuel with regards to it's an easy lap as far as fuel usage is concerned.
So Mario Andretti, on the false start, got a good jump on Bobby Rahal. Can he do it again? Again, Nick Fenoro looks down to the field. He has the flags ready. They look to be nicely aligned in the front as Rahal drops back just a bit, just ever so much. Again, they continue to look. They come into the long straightaway. There's the green flag. And again, it is Mario Andretti that jumps out in front. He's followed by Bobby Rahal. Coming down through the first turns now. Michael Andretti has dropped in third. Roberto Guerrero is fourth. And several cars get hard on the brakes. A real danger here on the first turn, and you can see the back end of the field played it very, very carefully as Andretti leads Rahal, followed by Michael Andretti and Roberto Guerrero.
Well, they're very clean through this first couple of corners. I saw young Michael Andretti going very wide on that last corner there, but he's lost a little ground on Rahal. You can see there's Guerrero. He's firmly in fourth position. Then you see Fittipaldi up there. Guerrero looking for a place. There's no to make a mistake. Here you see the young Al Unser Jr. over his shoulder. Watch his hands. Look at the kickback there. Drivers have a fairly strong upper body, strong wrists, forearms, shoulders. You only need to look at the Andretti boys to see there's a bit of beef there. and they certainly exercise it.
Ellinger Jr. started this race back in the fourth row, hopes to work his way up. Emerson Fittipaldi lies in fifth, and of course Mario Andretti jumped into the lead right at the start as we complete actually lap number two at the Meadowlands. And we watch Emerson Fittipaldi with Jeff Brabham just behind him. Jeff Brabham running in sixth place. Ellinger Jr. now running in seventh. And Jeff Brabham really moves out and is challenged by Ellinger Jr. So a good fight there right now between Jeff Brabham and Ellinger Jr., the fight for six, as we're back to the lead. There is Andretti, followed by Rahal, followed by Michael Andretti, and then Roberto Guerrero.
Michael Andretti very low in the cockpit of this car, and there we go back to Ellinger Jr. Now he'll be shifting gears here. There are about 23 gear shifts per lap. No room for error. You can see how close the barriers are. There's Michael Andretti. See how low he is in the car? In a street race, I used to always sit a little higher because I wanted better visibility of my front wheels because I was having to be so close to the barrier. You can see how close the cars are. Look at the rear wheel of that car in front there, almost touching the barrier. You can't afford to kiss the barrier.
Now Mario Andretti leads this race, followed by Bobby Rahal and Michael Andretti. We'll be back with more from the Meadowlands in a moment. He was the pole sitter here, the fastest man in qualifying 2 days ago because it rained yesterday and there weren't fast qualifying laps burned. He's being chased now by the defending national champion, Bobby Rahal, and there is a nice little battle developing between Jeff Brabham and Al Unser Jr. There you see the view from Al Unser's car as he tries to chase that number 15 car just ahead. It belongs to Jeff Brabham, and that's one of the cars with the Honda power and with a fuel management system, Jackie.
Well, he's going to have to work well with it. The fuel management system thinking for itself. There you see the car. There's Jeff Brabham. And there you see Unser there, the third car in your picture. Brabham's got away from him slightly. He's going to have to close up a little bit because if Brabham makes the slightest error of judgment, that's where it happens. It's just in an error of judgment that a driver can sneak through. It could be a missed gear shift. And round here with all these bumps, it's very easy to miss a shift. If you miss second or third gear, the other driver's going to be past you. Because remember, there are more than 700 horsepower in these race engines.
And of course, because of the way they're built, if you miss a shift, the engine will just immediately over-rev, tag the valves, and that engine could be done.
Well, they do have rev limiters fitted to those engines to try and stop valves being bent in an over-revving situation. But Unser's getting really close to Brabham now. He's really stalking him. He's looking for a place to go. You've got to be far enough away that you don't touch a wing. A front wing can be damaged very easily. We see that a lot in single-seater racing. These front wings are very big, but very vulnerable. Look at the wheel locked up.
Boy, he really locked them up coming in there.
Now, you've got to be careful. Once a wheel is locked up for that, it goes a little flat because the tires are very soft and compound, and if you lock the wheel up, it goes flat, and then you feel as if you've got your wheel out of balance. There's a thump every time it goes round. It can upset a driver if he does it too often.
And the further danger, of course, is when you do it, the car won't turn. It's going to carry on straight. Jeff Brabham currently rides in sixth place. He's being chased by Al Unser. And they are bracketed by the Patrick Racing Team. Currently riding just in front of Jeff is the 20 car of Emerson Fittipaldi. And just behind Al Unser, currently running in the eighth position, is the number seven car of Kevin Cogan. So this is where the battle is on the course, while Mario Andretti leads, being chased by Bobby Rahal and then by his son Michael.
Well, there you see Emerson Fittipaldi, lots of experience in road racing. And there you see again Al Unser Jr.'s car. He goes in there with his flameproof gloves on, bright day-glow colored. Fittipaldi getting a little bit of space to Brabham now. Brabham closing up under braking. There's Brabham. Accelerating hard. Fittipaldi rising over this Meadowlands racetrack here, changing surface between concrete and tarmac atom, the black top there. Fittipaldi not used to making mistakes. He's quite a sensible driver. Took the world championship away from me in 1972. I managed to wrest it back again in 1973. When he was racing in Grand Prix racing at that time, Fittipaldi was very hot. He's built a new life over here in America. He had retired from Grand Prix racing and, in fact, of motorsports of all kinds. Then came back, and my goodness, has he found a home.
And as we look now, we're watching a two-time World Driving Champion, followed by Jeff Brabham, the son of World Driving Champion Jack Brabham. They're on the pit straight, really the pit curve, as we watch them come through this track. Let's take them through, Jackie.
Well, that's 165 miles an hour they've just come from, and that's Fittipaldi in the top right-hand side there, you saw. Accelerating away now, he's getting up to about third gear, back into second gear for a left-hander, accelerating away. This is the off-camber right-hander for him, accelerating hard in second gear right now, getting it into third gear, accelerating hard again. It's a stop-go, because now he's in second gear again. Second gear, accelerating into third, then into fourth gear, as you see them there.
We look ahead to the front of the field, Jackie, here as Bobby Rahal is beginning now to challenge Mario Andretti, and Roberto Guerrero isn't so far behind.
Well, Mario may be backing off just a wee bit. If you're leading and you've got your pace right, as long as you don't make mistakes, nobody's going to pass you. You're going to use the road strategically where someone might be able to react. If Mario's backing off the pace, you'll see the rest of the pack, not only Rahal, closing up. And that doesn't seem to be happening right now as they come up to lap the slower cars. Rahal, you see, cannot get past Mario on the outside of a left-hand bend.
Bobby Rahal really with a desperate maneuver for so early on. He's very hard on the brakes there. Apparently he's seen the slower traffic. For example, Tony Bettenhausen, they just came around and was hoping to grab position and catch Mario sleeping.
Well, you see that Alonso, and there's Michael Andretti right now, and he's closed up as well. He's in third place, and he's behind Bobby Rahal right now, looking for a place, looking for a spot there. And there you see, look at them working that steering wheel there as they go through traffic. He's got to be very accurate. There you see the picture of those three.
Mario Andretti tries to hold off Bobby Rahal and young Michael Andretti. There he is, the number 18 car, that beautiful blue and yellow machine, pulls in just behind. John Richards, car number 27, pulled off the course on turn four. It didn't appear that he had any particular problem, but John Richards, in one of his first races here, out very early on. So at the moment, it is Mario Andretti that leads at the Meadowlands, followed by Bobby Rahal, Michael Andretti, and Roberto Guerrero. We're back at the Meadowlands. This is Paul Page with Jackie Stewart, Bruce Jenner, and Gary Gerald. You're watching Mario Andretti lead Bobby Rahal. No changes in the top of the field. In fact, the top 10 of this race have remained static from the beginning, from the green flag. Andretti leads it, followed by Rahal, followed by Michael Andretti, and then Roberto Guerrero, Emerson Fittipaldi, Jeff Brabham, Alan Tur Jr., Kevin Cogan, Danny Sullivan, and Tom Sneva. This is Michael Andretti's ride. And if you will notice, up on the dashboard there is part of that fuel management system. It is a readout device that will actually tell him laps to go in the race. And fuel, Jackie Stewart, is going to be very important here today.
It is indeed. There's 100 laps to go around here, 168 miles in total, and he's going to have to be watching. That fuel gauge, which is just covered by his hand for the moment, it gives him those digital readouts of laps to go, and he will know how he's doing on fuel. It seems to be that Michael Andretti's driving just a little bit harder than either his father or Bobby Rahal. I saw his car getting loose, that's to say he had oversteer, the back end was kicking out in a couple of places, and I think he's having to drive it just a bit harder.
Mario Andretti still out in front. Let's go down to the pit area now. Bruce Jenner.
Thank you, Paul. With me is Steve Horn. And Steve, the Bobby Rahal team seems to be so confident this year, even at the beginning of the season. Last year, you only had 28 points. This time, 53. You're coming off a big win at Portland, and it's just very exciting for the team, and the confidence level seems to be high.
Well, you know, True Sports is still the same bunch of guys we had last year, and we're still doing the same thing we want to do, and that's try and win races. And we've got a good car. We're learning about the car, and Bobby really is driving well. So, we're doing okay, we think.
All right, and you seem to make the right decision with the Cosworth and the Lola at the beginning of the year using that chassis. So congratulations, you guys. Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Paul?
And already the story begins to tell here as we are having indications of some problems in the leaders. Roberto Guerrero has dropped out of this front fight as Michael Andretti comes inside, tries it inside Bobby Rahal. That's where Danny Sullivan passed him last year, but Rahal isn't going to give up. You see Rahal come to the inside. That car that they just passed is Roberto Guerrero, who has rolled to a stop. He was running in fourth, and he's now pulled off the edge of the course.
Well, he's in big trouble in that case. We're certainly going to lose him. chances of him getting back to the start finishing line, therefore back to the pits, would be remote from here. You could call his day finished, really, unless something extraordinary occurs. But certainly, Michael Andretti almost had Bobby Rahal. It seems that something occurred where Rahal had a bit of a run at him, but I thought he had almost made the pass.
Exactly the same maneuver that Danny Sullivan used last year to get around Rahal and win the race. And this year, Rahal said, I'm not having any of that. Nobody's coming inside. There is Roberto Guerrero by the edge of the course. Let's go to the pits and Gary Gerrell.
Paul, we were standing here at the moment when they got word on the radio. Roberto just called in and said the motor quit. We don't know specifically what the problem was. Immediate great disappointment, because this is the third consecutive race now where he's experienced misfortune. They had such high hopes because they had tested so extensively down in Phoenix at Firebird Lake with its fuel management system. However, they're not even going to be in long enough to give it a true test under race conditions today. Great disappointment for Guerrero.
Well, Gary, out on the circuit, they have got Roberto Guerrero started again, so maybe he'll make it to the pits and they can fix the problem. Roberto Guerrero, a likable man who has had an incredible amount of bad luck.
Well, who's your favorite race car driver?
Daddy?
Yeah.
Marco's daddy is Roberto Guerrero, and this two-year-old tyke isn't alone in his admiration for the 27-year-old Colombian. Roberto is the favorite of many, but being a Guerrero fan can be stressful. It was just last fall here on NBC that Roberto led all but the last lap of the Miami Challenge.
The white flag in the hands of Nick Fenaro. Just one more lap to go in the 1986 season as Roberto Guerrero's engine falters. Little Al closes down. His fuel light is burning steadily, but Little Al comes to the inside and Little Al takes the lead as Roberto Guerrero slows, apparently out of fuel on the final lap.
But his luck changed this year at Phoenix when he won against all odds. Starting last, Guerrero battled his way to the front only to run over a tire and be penalized while running in the lead. Still, he scored his first IndyCar win.
I was watching from the PPG tent, and when I saw that happen, I thought, here we go again, this is perfect. And I start to leave, I'm all depressed, and then some people up in the stands turn around and say, He's out again. He's still in the lead. And I went crazy.
Yeah, because you just saw me going in the pit. You didn't actually know that it was a penalty. You weren't in the pit, so.
So I thought, I thought that was the end of our day, and that would have been kind of par for the course for years past. But oh, what a day that was to finally win one. That was terrific, especially in such a fashion.
But since then, Roberto's runs have been a series of near misses. 2 weeks ago at Portland, Roberto was the pole sitter, only to have his engine fail. 4 weeks ago at Milwaukee, Roberto was the pole sitter and leading the race when his engine let go. And worst of all, 5 weeks ago at the Indianapolis 500, Guerrero was leading with just 72 miles to go when his car faltered on his final pit stop, and Roberto watched Al Unser drive by and into the winner's circle. Guerrero was devastated. But immediately bounced back when Marco was handed to him.
I just burst into tears. I couldn't control myself. I was devastated.
It was when we walked up and the steering wheel missed the car completely and was somewhere out there. I thought, okay, everybody stand back.
Roberto survived such trials because of a close-knit family.
When I saw Marco, things weren't so bad after all. So it was... That's nice to be able to have that, because then you say, well, you know.
In addition to his close family support, Guerrero has a finely tuned sense of humor. His car owner, Vince Granatelli, like his father, Andy Granatelli, is in the habit of hugging and kissing his winning drivers. According to Roberto, that fact alone is the only advantage to coming in second.
Unfortunately, it's great disappointment right now. The team manager, Vince, what is the problem? Do you know specifically what happened?
Well, it appears that in his slower corners, he had a little bit of a lean condition, and the engine quit running momentarily. But we're back on the road now, and hopefully we can make up some of the time that we lost.
You're going to leave him out, not bring him in?
Yeah, we've left him out. We know the situation that we had a lean condition that caused the engine to quit, and I think think that if we can just keep right on running, that we still will have a respectable finish for the True Value car.
Okay, that's the word from the Vince Granatelli Racing Roberto Romero pit, Paul.
Thank you, Gary. So while they're in the pits, action on the course. Look at Michael Andretti. Michael Andretti comes down inside. Ray Hall gets past. Ray Hall now sets his sight on his dad. Michael Andretti really on the fly here at the Meadowlands. Michael Andretti desperately wants to lead this race. Let's see if he can get it done. He closes up. They pass the slower car of Randy Lewis. Now Michael Andretti has his mark set on his father, Mario Andretti. We'll be back in just a moment.
Straight.
This is Paul Page. We are back at the Meadowlands with Michael Andretti in hot pursuit of his father, Mario, the pole sitter. Led the race from the start, but now Michael is charging right down behind. Just moments ago, Michael got around Bobby Rahal. Now can he get his father? He comes to the inside, brushes his dad, and Michael Andretti, after popping into the side of his father's tires, takes over, and Rahal closes up trying to challenge Mario.
Not the experience of Mario. He managed to get around it, though.
Let's go to the pits, Gary.
Just four pits away from the disappointment of Roberto Guerrero, Michael Andretti's people here are ecstatic because they've now moved from that second row, third starting position into the lead. This is the man that leads the national championship in the point standing, starting the second third of the season. They have great expectations. They're also using that fuel management system today. They're hoping that its reliability will put them in victory lane.
So some changes now here at the Meadowlands. The race originally led by Mario Andretti, now being led by his son Michael, followed by Bobby Rahal, Emerson Fittipaldi, Jeff Brabham. Sixth place is Little Al, followed by Kevin Kogan, Danny Sullivan, Jose Legarza, and Tom Sneva. Sneva making the best move really up through the field as he's moved up to the 10th place, and Sneva started in 14th. That move and Michael's moves are the two big ones of the day.
Well, Michael is just drawing away almost as he wishes at the present time. He's just opened up an enormous gap as he goes into this second gear corner. There you see Father and Ray Hall close behind there, the two first cars in your picture. But something's gone wrong because it seems to me that they're going slowly, whereas Michael's going out and attacking the racetrack, and Fittipaldi is closing up on Ray Hall and Andretti Sr. So we've got a slightly different pace here. It could be that Ray Hall is not as aggressive at getting past Mario. Let's see what Fittipaldi does, because he could give both of them a hard time because he's certainly closed up.
Still on this very tight circuit, the first five cars are all within 6 seconds of the leader, but Michael Andretti is indeed beginning to pull away, and that means the fight now moves back second, third, and fourth. It's really a three-way battle for second place, currently occupied by Mario Andretti, but Bobby Rahal is right there, and as you can see, the interval back to Emerson Fittipaldi is really not so far.
No, it does seem to me that Fittipaldi is making a show here, whether he's good enough, and maybe Andretti's timing went a little bit out, because what does occur when a driver is overtaken like that and taken by surprise and there was contact, it could be that Mario's flow and timing maybe just have gone off. It does seem, however, he's a little slow in certain parts of the track. He certainly was closed up under braking. I wonder if maybe his brake balance is not quite what it should be, because in fact it seemed to be a relatively easy pass for Michael when he passed him, and then Bobby Rahal nearly got him on two corners ago.
Whatever it is, Rahal seems to sense it. You'll notice that Mario is using a slightly different line than Rahal, and Fittipaldi seems satisfied to follow the line being used by Rahal.
Well, let's just watch this, because Fittipaldi seems to grab a lot of attention, get up close, and then the other two seem to run away from him a little bit. It's not unusual in road courses as tight as it. Look how Rahal is closing up there. Fittipaldi not quite as close as he was. This is what happens when one driver and one car has a slight handling advantage on one part of the track.
You saw Michael Andretti just seconds ago, who has a 2.5-second lead over the second-place car of his father. There you see the interval as we watch them come down. And again, Rahal moves to a more outside line as Mario comes to the inside.
This is a tight part of the racetrack. You wouldn't expect anyone to get past right here. Now going to brake heavily for a first-gear corner, right-hand first gear here, grabbing it into second gear almost immediately, accelerating up onto the concrete there, coming back onto tarmac. Adam, see how bumpy it is. Mario Andretti also sitting low in the car, very similar to his son, like father, like son, not seeing a lot of the race car out front there, but those three cars almost glued together for the moment as the second three in the picture, and then Brabham's closing up also. It does seem that Mario's pace has slowed down, but it's not a fact of young Michael accelerating away. Look at this, Rahal trying to find a place to get past here, trying to find a way around.
They thread their way under the 21 car of Johnny Rutherford. Mario Andretti, car number five, being chased by the number one of Bobby Rahal. And saw just a puff of blue vapor at the back of Fittipaldi's car, I thought.
That was maybe lifting off the accelerator. May just have been a puff there. He may have taken his foot off the gas a little too sharply. You have a vapor factor sometimes in that. But look how close. In fact, Jeff Brabham is coming to Fittipaldi. That, to me, means that they're stacking up. And that's where I'm looking for Fittipaldi, diving inside of Bobby Rahal and then going for Mario.
It's an ongoing three-way battle for second place. Let's consider the engines here. Mario has the Ilmor Chevrolet racing engine. Bobby Rahal has the traditional Cosworth power. And Emerson Fittipaldi has the Chevrolet racing engine. They put power down differently as we look at Mario Andretti.
Well, a man of about my year, he's in fact a year younger than I am, or close to, let's call it 6 months younger than I am. It's certainly a man with oodles of experience, driven the Indy 500 very successfully, obviously has won that race, and the Daytona 500, and the Le Mans 24-hour race. He's just done everything, won the world championship.
Mario Andretti wins in everything he does, and at age 47, he continues to love his racing, still trying to hold off Bobby Rahal. The front of the field, the top 10, all remaining static now, as Rahal and Andretti battle for second place with Fittipaldi, and now, as Jackie Stewart mentioned moments ago, Jeff Brabham begins to close up, and they are watching this fight as well. One interesting fact, the first car reported out, which was that of John Richards, was reported out with transmission problem. And Jackie, you're worried about the transmissions here.
Yes, it seems to me that this fierce acceleration, a lot of second gear corners and one first gear corner, when the gears are that low and you're transmitting that 700 plus horsepower, it's an enormous task for the rest of the machinery to hold up. Drive shafts, constant velocity joints, universal joints, and even the splines within the gearbox itself can be stripped. And the driver has to be very careful when he's going down through the box as well as going up through the box. Some of the drivers jump from fourth to second. In a track like this, it's always better to go from fourth to third to second so that you're giving the gearbox a progression. And you should use the brakes for going down the way. Keep that in mind on the road also. Brakes are for stopping. Gearboxes are for going up the way.
So as they work their way back off and on different sections of roadway here at the Meadowlands, you just saw Roberto Guerrero come by. He's physically just ahead of Al Unser on the racetrack, but he is well down and out of the competition, really, as a result of that stop. He's not in the top 15 on the track, currently running 22nd on this circuit. There you see Roberto Guerrero. He has a long way to make up, but let's remember that he started in last position at Phoenix, drove his way to the front, had a penalty, a stop and go, was brought into the pits, sent back out, and still won the race. So it may not be over yet.
This is a new combination of mechanics, teams, car owners, and so forth this year for this operation. I'm afraid it does show. It's that mechanical reliability you get from a team that's well put together, such as Andretti has with Carl Haas. Of course, Bobby Rahal's got it with his team, the Red Roof team. That's something that only comes in time. Seldom does a driver and the team lock together and immediately find success. And I'm afraid Guerrero's finding that situation troublesome for him in this year of 87.
Well, as you can see, Roberto Guerrero is capable of running with the leaders as he's right behind that battle for second place now. We'll be back. Meadowlands, where Michael Andretti leads in the battle for second place between Mario Andretti and Bobby Rahal, just worked their way past the Rainer car of Derek Daly. And it is coming very close to time for the pit stops. The fuel low light on Michael Andretti's dash has been flickering off and on. He watches it. He knows exactly how far it can go before he must head for the pits. And of course, if it's flickering for him, then other people are running low as well.
Well, already Danny Sullivan's been in for fuel and gone out. There we can look again for this light. It'll see it in the left-hand side of your screen if it's going to come on. You just saw a flash of it there, as a matter of fact. You'll only see it on right-hand bends. It's coming up now to the fastest part of the racetrack, which is about 165 miles an hour. Accelerating hard. There he goes. Full chat. And we've got a
action
problem.
In turn four, that's Jose Legarza. That's that off-cambered corner leading up to the bridge. The leaders are already past here. But Garza is stopped in a very precarious position, and you can see that the wheels are badly damaged, and the car certainly will have to be removed from that area with a wrecker. Now, the question becomes, will they only use the yellow flag in this area, which is the road course rule? But they have the option of using the yellow flag all around the circuit. Look, and Michael dropped just inside, actually goes over a little bit of debris from the accident as he comes across the bridge. Now, will they go full course at yellow? If they do that, it's a tremendous advantage to the leaders.
Well, what's going to happen? I'm looking out of a commentary position, looking for the flagman, for Michael Andretti. Running over any form of debris could be a real problem. It looks like, in fact, Bobby Rahal's got something stuck to the nose cone of his car as he comes round. Do you see the white thing there? Is that paper, or is that a piece of the other car? But this, there, Garza's finally got out the car. I don't think he realized that he was quite as badly damaged as it was. It seems that Mario Andretti is thinking of coming into the pits, but Garza there sat in the car for quite a while. He didn't know that the right rear wheel was almost torn off.
Not he's unusual. Angry at somebody as here comes Michael Andretti. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
It's the marker. Mario comes in right in front of him now. Here's Jeff Brabham, Little Al. They're all coming in. Michael Andretti, the leader, a man who's run so well here in the past, is going for fresh rubber all the way around. Jim Wilson, the vet man, fueling. At this time, the fuel hose is uncoupled, waiting to bring the car down off the jack that's still up. Could be a problem on the left rear. They go back to the left rear side. They want it down off the jack. It's still up. Now they get it down. He engages the clutch and he's away, but it was a longer stop than he wanted.
And as Michael Andretti rolled into the pits, and by the way, Michael Andretti, Mario Andretti, Bobby Rahal, they all made their stops, and those stops came right on schedule. But as we suggested, they have now displayed the yellow flag at the start-finish line and all around the race course. So we're full course yellow. That will pack the field up.
But Bobby Rahal on the road is now in the lead.
Bobby Rahal indeed got out in front. And this is the interesting thing of the Indy cars in road racing with the pit stops mixed in. Once Michael got in front, he was really only able to manage 2-3 seconds out in front. So the race left his hands, now went to the pit crews to do their job.
Well, the pit crew, of course, vital in any kind of pit stop with wheel changing and fuel adding. Every time you come into the pits, Paul, I always saw it to be a risk. It only needs one of that very efficient team to do something marginally wrong, and it truly affects the whole pit stop in a mammoth way. And that's what sort of happened right now. There was a hiccup there, and Bobby Rahal's pit, a little bit slicker, has now got the lead.
So Jim Prescott and the True Sports crew proved their worth today, putting their driver out first as Bobby Rahal now leads under yellow at the Meadowlands. We'll be back. Ricky Stewart, we are back at the Meadowlands under a full course yellow, and the reason for the yellow, look at the light-colored car. That is Jose Lee Garza as he smacked the wall on the approach to the off-camber turn four and then went into the side of Ludwig Heimrath, tapping him, but Ludwig Heimrath Jr. has continued on. Garza climbed out of the car. He is uninjured, but obviously the car badly damaged, and so it will not continue. Let's go to the pits. Bruce Jenner.
Paul Page, we've mentioned so many times that the pit crew is really the one that can win these races. And the Budweiser True Sports team just literally pounced on Rahal's car in that last pit stop, got the car in and out faster than anybody else, and it put Bobby Rahal in the lead. But you did mention that there was something on the front of Bobby Rahal's car, and actually it was the nose piece of Jose Legarra's car, but it didn't seem to do any damage, and I think it's going to be working fine. Probably the car that's working the best out there is Michael Andretti's, and Gary Gerald is in his pit.
First, the problem that Michael had in that pit stop, the air jack came down, it pinched off the air hose. Consequently, they couldn't use the wrench on the left rear. By the time they figured out what the problem was, they got the wrench from the right side over there, but they didn't get the tire changed. It was a longer stop than expected. He lost three positions, and he has the original rubber still on the left rear. Paul?
So Gary, Michael Andretti, who moved his way up past his father, and then with that pit stop, dropped back into fourth place. Bobby Rahal leads it as we're ready to come back to the green flag. The green flag flies. You're watching from Michael Andretti's car, currently running in fourth place. Bobby Rahal takes them past the start-finish line. Directly in front of Michael is Al Unser Jr. As some slower traffic, they come around Rick Mears, they come around Dick Simon, and the leader, Bobby Rahal, now has a clear run just ahead of him. It is still Mario Andretti and Al Unser Jr. that have to deal with Rick Mears, that bright yellow Pennzoil car number 8. And now they work their way past into the off-cambered corner. Very tight going here. You can see how narrow it is as we watch from Al Unser Jr.'s car.
And Al Unser really choked off Rick Mears there. He did a big job on him, and he did get it into first gear, did get a clean line and accelerated away. It's from his car that we look now. This is Alonso Jr.'s car, accelerating hard. It's in third gear, heavily braking.
That's Mario Andretti, the red number five, just ahead, the second place car. His son, Michael, look, is already pulled so far ahead. I say Michael, I meant Bobby Rahal. He gave a test with the Michael beater. Michael's back in fourth place as a result of that bad pit stop.
Well, in fact, Alonso Jr. sticking very close to Papa Andretti there. He's really hustling.
Good tight fight here for second place as we watch over the right shoulder of Little Al. Little Al pulls to the wider line. Mario pulls to the inside, trying to get the better exit through this corner. Does so, comes to the outside. The fight continues.
It does seem to me that Mario's having a little bit of trouble because he's using unconventional lines as Alonso Jr. tries to go under on braking. Very experienced driver to try and do that against because Andretti knows where he wants to go. He's never an easy man to pass, Mario, even in my racing days. Paid a lot of attention to where you chose to pass Mario Andretti. He was a very firmly Laporte, closing of the door gentleman.
Well, the circuit at the Meadowlands is particularly narrow, and when Mario Andretti wants to, he can have a very wide race car. As you can see, the view from Al Unser's car. Number five, Mario Andretti works his way around, running in second place.
Each driver has to
Al Unser Jr. right behind Mario Andretti right now, trying to catch him. Running in fourth place, Fittipaldi is fifth. Sixth is Jeff Brabham. Kevin Cogan is seventh. There you see Mario, and right behind him, the number 30 car, the hot one of Al Unser Jr. By the way, an interesting announcement this week. We've been waiting the arrival of Porsche into the IndyCar racing. They're making a Porsche chassis, a Porsche-powered machine. It'll make its debut in the IndyCars at Nazareth, Pennsylvania, that new race there. And the driver will be Little Al's father. Al Unser Jr. has been nominated to drive the rest of the season.
Al Unser Sr. going to drive the Porsche. Old Al, as I call him, instead of young Al.
We're watching Bobby Rahal, the leader, car number one. The defending national champion. He was leading here last year until he was pushed aside by Danny Sullivan.
You know, it goes back a little bit further than just the bang. Bobby had been running pretty strong, but so had we. And he had made a pit stop. We had already made our pit stop. And we had run probably two laps, I guess. We had a little bit lighter fuel load. Not a lot, but just a little bit. And my pitch yelling at me, come on, he's in the pit, get down here if you can pass him. And I'm sure his pit's telling him to get out as fast as possible. When he came out right in front of me and just shut the door going down into the second turn. And then I followed him, I think, for two laps. And, of course, I hadn't had a clutch since the second lap of the race. And I was a little quicker out of the hairpin out of four. And when we went down into five, I went and made my move. And I think he may have seen it a little bit later than he wanted to, and he went just a little bit to close the door, and I was already committed, and we both banged wheels.
We were really fortunate we made it to the end anyway. It bent the whole left side of the suspension, front and rear, and it's sort of a miracle the thing made it to the end, so maybe we have to thank ourselves for, you know, for small favors in that regard. But I guess the whole idea is to be able to go fast enough where nobody can get close enough to you, where you don't risk that sort of thing. So that's what we've got to work on this year.
The situation 1 year ago and how the drivers now view it 1 year later. Young Michael Andretti under challenge by Jeff Brabham, the 15th car of Brabham, the Honda-powered machine. The fight is for fourth. Bobby Rahal leads. Mario Andretti is second. Al Unser Jr. is third. This is the fight for fourth place.
It seems to me that young Al has been going well, but young Michael hasn't been able to come back out of that pit stop. Keep in mind that it seems that he does have on that left rear wheel a tire that's had the full distance of the race, unlike Jeff Brabham and the other runners who have been able to put fresh rubber in all four wheels. Particularly, the left rear is going to be under a lot of temperature, and that could be the difference between him not being obviously as fast as he was in the earlier part of this race.
So this is the fight on the circuit now. It is a battle for fourth. We watch Michael Andretti, and he now and then can check that mirror and realize that Jeff Brabham is right there. And of course, Jeff Brabham, a desperate man. He's been a bridesmaid three times, but he has never seen the checkered flag out in front of the field. He has been oh so close, and he has run at the front, and he looks now for his first opportunity to win.
Well, Jack Brabham, Sir Jack as he is now, was a slow starter in his career. He didn't shoot to prominence the way that some drivers did, such as Jim Clark, etc. And it did take him a number of years. Maybe the same thing's going to happen with him.
A Can-Am champion, great driver, now riding in fifth place and trying for fourth as Bobby Rahal leads, followed by Mario Andretti. We'll be back. This is Paul Page with Jackie Stewart. We are back at the Meadowlands. We're watching Michael Andretti running in fourth place. But Jeff Brabham is just behind that car number 15. There's Jeff. And other cars now have begun to close. Emerson Fittipaldi and Kevin Cogan have come into view as well. And even Roberto Guerrero is there. Now, Guerrero is well off the pace. But the important point is he is running pace with the leaders. So his earlier problem, apparently with the fuel system, has been solved. And he's back at full check.
Well, it doesn't seem that he's going to be much of an impression because he's going to have to unlap himself and catch up a lot of time. But I wouldn't have expected anything less of him to run with the pace as long as his car was running in full condition. Emerson Fittipaldi at the bottom of your screen. Guerrero there in the bright colored car, the STP car. Vince Granatelli taking over from his father, who certainly became very famous in IndyCar racing.
Out in front is Bobby Rahal. He's followed by Mario Andretti. In third place is Al Unser. Let's go to Jeff Brabham's pit now and Gary Gerrell.
Well, a lot of people have been saying for years that Jeff Brabham is due for a victory. Four times he's finished second. He keeps knocking on the door. He keeps getting close, but he can't quite get over that hurdle. Well, now in the last two events, they've added aerodynamicist Tony Sicali to this team. Tony is right over here charting the activity lap by lap. Rick Gallus told us yesterday in the practice session when this team was the fastest on the course, a lot of the credit has to go to this man, Tony Sicali. They're refocused, they're confident, they're hoping, they're challenging now in fifth place. Paul?
Sicali from New England, one of the brilliant young men at making air move over the car perfectly. And of course, since there is still some ground effects in these Indianapolis type cars, it is extremely important to have that aerodynamicist on the team to get the car around the circuit and keep it stuck to the ground, as we watch Jeff Brabham.
Well, Jeff Brabham, one of three brothers, all driving racing cars now. Young David has just started in Australia. Gary Brabham is driving Formula 3 in Britain. And Jeff Brabham, of course, has made his home in America now for many, many years. Certainly a full racing family. You have that in America with the Andretti's and the Unsers and the Bettenhausers, even the Vukovic's before that.
Speaking of racing families, the Stewart clan now has another entrant. Your son, Paul, in fact, starting on the pole today in England.
Yes, sadly, he started to take up motor racing. I'd rather he was a tennis player and kept his old man in the comforts that he's grown accustomed to. But he was in pole position, his first ever time in Formula Ford. He got the lead again after having a slow start and then spun out. Not too Stewart-like on this occasion.
Didn't start like you did, eh, Jack? Well, look, Bobby Rahal is the leader of this race. Mario Andretti is in second, Ellinger Jr. in third. Roberto Guerrero, you watch him there right behind Emerson Fittipaldi, though he is not on the leader lap. He is well off the pace, at least three laps behind Emerson Fittipaldi. Bobby Rahal, as we take a look, leads the race. 48 laps are now gone. We've changed three times in the leaders. Mario had it at the beginning, and it was picked up by Michael, and now Bobby Rahal. So the average speed seems down a bit. 85 doesn't seem like a fast speed, but believe me, as narrow as this circuit is, it is very fast. As you see as we look over Michael Andretti's shoulder.
Keep in mind, they qualified at 99.108 miles an hour, so the pace is slower. But when they qualify, they're on very low fuel. The cars are set up for qualifying for literally doing just those few laps. Bobby Rahal driving very, very neatly. This is the way that you do win races on a road course. You don't want to be over spectacular. You don't want emotion to take hold. It's very easy for a driver to get overexcited when he's leading a race. Emotion can be the most damaging thing of all, whether it's through elation or disappointment. It happens all the time in racing, and the drivers that can eliminate emotion are the ones who can win most races.
The car carries the number one of the defending national champion, the driver, of course, Bobby Rahal, last year's Indianapolis 500 winner. He is second in the point standings to this man, Michael Andretti. Now, Rahal currently has 53 points, which is further ahead in PPG IndyCar points than he has ever been at this point in the season. So perhaps he is chasing a second national championship. On the other hand, this man, Michael Andretti, currently racing in fourth place, leads the points fight. And he can move ahead handily if he stays in this position.
as we watch from now high over the Meadowlands Sports Complex. Michael Andretti, who runs in fourth place, and the 15 car right behind him is that of Jeff Brabham.
Well, I would expect Michael Andretti to improve his position at the next pit stop, because I think when he gets new rubber, he's going to be able to drive this car just a little bit more aggressively. And at this stage in his career, he is an aggressive driver. He's not a laid-back waiting driver. His father can afford to do that because of his experience and maturity. A younger driver needs that adrenaline pumping, needs the car to go well to do the job he wants it to do.
They come over the state highway, across the bridge, past the disabled car there, and now down around that turn five, which is where most of the passing occurs here at the Meadowlands. It was the key position for the pass last year, where Danny Sullivan got past Bobby Rahal. It was the key position in the pass this year, when Michael Andretti was able to finally move past his father. He used turn five to set the pass up. We watch now as Bobby Rahal encounters the slower traffic. Scotty Brayton, the Amway car, comes inside. Rahal still running out in front, and he has 4 seconds over the second place car of Mario Andretti.
4 seconds doesn't seem a lot in life, but as long as you don't make mistakes, it keeps that pace. The driver behind has to be able to keep the pace also, and it's quite often that the leader will get better service from flag marshals, the blue flag meaning move over, there's another car coming behind. And if that leader is the man who's coming up behind the slower car, the flag marshals tend to be very enthusiastic, giving him a slightly better chance than the man who's in second place. Mario Andretti can find his way back under most circumstances and round most cars.
Well, let's go to the pits once again. Here's Gary Gerrell.
Well, Paul, down here at Mario's pits, an interesting radio conversation we were made aware of a short time ago. It relates to weather conditions. Not a threat of rain, but Mario says when the sun is shining brightly, his car is wiggly on the track. It's not handling as well. He likes the cloud cover. And so the crew down here keeps looking up to the sky, hoping that one of these clouds will roll in, block the view of the sun, improve their handling characteristics.
Well, Gary Gerrell, there may be good news for Mario then. While rain is not the threat, there is a cloud cover that seems to be rolling in over the Meadowlands here, as again we look over Michael Andretti's shoulder, and that shows you, Jackie Stewart, how sensitive the suspensions and tires are to even the slightest change. Sun comes out, the surface gets just a little hotter and changes everything.
Well, it's the tires that's doing that, actually, Paul. The higher temperature, that's the ambient temperature, makes a big difference to the compounds. Those compounds are very sophisticated today. For Mario Andretti, he will have to drive more gently to keep the tire temperatures down. If it's cloudy, those tire temperatures stay lower than when the sun is out. It's a very strong sun here. We do have good cloud cover, and it seems to be increasing.
Another situation, as there are other stories developing here at the Meadowlands, as we continue to watch the second place car, the number five machine of Mario Andretti. Here's Michael. Michael again running in fourth place and being chased by Jeff Brabham. Just ahead of him is Rick Mears, but Rick is off the pace running 15th right now. So Michael would like to get around. Other stories. They tested a dog leg at Michigan International Speedway this past week. It was an idea to perhaps slow the cars down, those tremendous speeds on the high banks of Michigan International. They decided the dog leg didn't work, so CART has today announced that they will reduce the boost for the Michigan 500 down to 45 inches, so that should slow the cars down.
I wonder how that'll affect some of the teams who have been making engines specially for a boost factor. Perhaps people like Porsche coming in don't like the idea of regulations changing as rapidly as that. But the new chicane apparently cost $75,000 just to test, and it's not going to be used.
And Rick Mears indicated if you take it down to 45 inches, you may slow it down to 210. We'll be back with more from the Meadowlands right after this as Bobby Rahal leaves. Back at the Meadowlands, this is Paul Page. Let's go to the pits, Gary Gerrell.
Paul, there was definitely contact between Kogan and either a barrier or another car. They have quickly tried to replace the front wing, working on both sides of the nose of the car. The engine has been shut down. They routinely change the tires in the rear that would have been flat spotted with that spin, but the major problem for Kevin Kogan now relates to the aerodynamics up front.
Gary Gerrell, this situation results as a result of contact on the circuit with Danny Sullivan, the defending champion. And you can see Danny Sullivan's car disabled by the roadside, the right front tilted totally askew. and the defending champion here, Danny Sullivan, out of the car and out of the race.
Well, that was quite a good contact patch. They got, it wasn't a slow part of the circuit. They were knocking on there, and it did seem they hit fairly substantial contact. And, of course, one of the cars spun without hitting the wall, it seemed, and, of course, that was gone. There's Danny Sullivan, fairly perspiring in this warm day in the Meadowlands, but he is walking home, which must be a relief.
Bobby Rahal is the leader at the Meadowlands, a four-second lead over Mario Andretti. Third place is Al Unser Jr., who is well back off of first and second. And this car, Michael Andretti, now begins to close on Al Unser Jr. That's Al sitting just ahead, and Michael is trying to play catch-up and grab third place. So the fight on the circuit now is for third, as we have the two camera cars riding right together. Little Al, car 30, has one. Car 18, Michael Andretti, has the other. The two second-generation drivers now begin a fight for third place.
This will be interesting. This is youth fighting youth, and, of course, two famous names of American motor racing, Andretti's and the Unsers, tooth and nail together.
And two drivers who couldn't know one another better. As small children, they played with one another while at the circuits with their fathers, and then they began racing one another in anything that had a motor and wheels. Now they're in some of the finest cars in the world, the Indy cars, with their tremendous 750 to 800 horsepower engines, and they're propelling them down this very tight circuit at the Meadowlands. Al Unser Jr. and Michael Andretti now do battle, and the honor is for third place.
Let's look how close they go to the curbs and to the walls, just touching those curbstones neatly. Very precise driving by Al Unser Jr. as we look over the shoulder of Michael Andretti. Here's the shot of how close they are together. These cameras, the lens sometimes lie a little bit, and it doesn't give us quite as close an impression of those cars as you would think. Looking for a way past. There he goes. Al's looking for it, but of course this is such a busy racetrack. No opportunity. Now he's got him. Will Michael get past?
Michael's going to try him. Michael comes to the outside, can't do it. He's blocked. They both pass Tony Bettenhausen, who waves them past, but it's difficult to find an opening even when the driver wants you to go by.
Only if you miss a gear shift. Only if you miss the apex and get out of line. First gear now. Look at this acceleration. It seems that Michael's using less road than young Al as he tries to come alongside. He can't do it. There he's looking for another way. Has he done it yet?
Again, a pass at turn five. A key position on the circuit. But there you saw wonderfully so the setup. You saw Michael push him and push him and finally force him up and onto the curb and then finally push his way past at that key corner here, the fifth turn.
What a wonderful medium this on-car camera business is. We saw the entire action. This is what you call experiential television. You could be in the cockpit. You saw the driver's hands. You saw the move.
The battle there for third place, and Al Unser Jr. was able to hold Michael Andretti only so long, and then Michael Andretti came past, and you got to see it from onboard camera on two different machines. Here it is from Michael's view once again, Jackie Stewart.
He just takes advantage of the slower car. Bettenhausen, he tries to get it under braking. He's not going to do it under braking. He then thinks, where can I do it next? Watch for the move here. He accelerates out. He's using a little bit of less road. He's now getting into the draft. There's not a great deal of aerodynamic help.
He forces Al into the right. Now watch this. He'll force him in, which gives Michael a little better exit.
No, but actually, Al had a bit of oversteer there. He didn't get out of that corner as smoothly. You could see the back end kicking out, and it was that little bit of loss of adhesion that allowed Michael Andretti to get through.
So a wonderful fight. Bobby Rahal still the leader, but Michael Andretti now runs in third behind his father. The only two cars, though, on the lead lap at this moment, Bobby Rahal and Mario Andretti. And look now as Michael Andretti pours the power on and drives away as we look over the shoulder of Little Al.
Well, this gives you some indication what can occur from time to time. A driver can overtake and then have the racetrack to himself, and he can pull away. It's just the fact that Michael Andretti could not find a place suitable to pass Al Unser Jr. that allowed him to be held up in the fashion that he has. Now we'll see if Michael Andretti can close the gap that he has to close to get close to Daddy.
So Michael Andretti tries to charge. Bobby Rahal leads, and Mario is in second. We'll be back. We're back at the Meadowlands Indy as Al Unser Jr., who was running in fifth place, comes into the pits. Let's go to Bruce Jenner.
They are putting all tires all the way around, and they're coming in. They're also making an adjustment to the front wing for the run wing as he immediately tries to hustle out of there. He's having trouble getting it in gear. Finally does get it in gear, smokes the tires, and Al Unser, looking for his first victory of the year, is out of the pits.
But Al Unser Jr. really had to kick it. Now he slows down, Jackie.
It seems the engine stalled. The engine did stall. He got it away. He got it in first gear. He jumped into second gear, and then the engine just died solid.
You see the light burning. It says the oil pressure is low, which tells you it's totally shut off right now. He's stopped on the pit road.
Well, the engine is stopped. He's speaking to his radio, it seemed there. I thought he was trying to speak into his mic there, but that's a problem for him. His crew, no doubt, will be trying to get to him. But what a disaster for him. Everybody passes by.
What a terrible wait this is for a driver to have to sit by the edge of the circuit and hope that the crew can come down, and then hope that whatever it is, hopefully it's just that the engine died because he had trouble pulling away. And look at that tremendous frustration. He clutches his fist, bangs on the steering wheel. He was having such a wonderful run, was up with the leaders, and now quickly begins to drop back through the field. He's already fallen back to sixth place. Bobby Rahal is the leader. Mario Andretti is second. Michael Andretti is third. And now the front of the field begins to close down just a little bit on Rahal, but Rahal is definitely commanding the race. And here comes Mario Andretti, the second place car to the pits, and Gary Gerald.
Mario hits his spot. They go to work immediately. 5 men over the wall. All looks routine. This should be the final stop. Precious seconds right now, because it's so tough to make them up on this demanding Meadowlands race course. Fresh rubber all the way around. They have the tires in place. They're waiting to get the full load of fuel. He comes down off the jacks. 19 seconds on the stop, and Mario's away.
Colin Duff and the fine Haas Newman Haas crew does a really good job getting Mario out.
For me, watching Mario Andretti there, as we see little Al being pushed back into his pit by the kart officials, as well as
his
own mechanics.
That's Dennis Swan, the team manager, yep, trying to get him back.
But, they were directing the other side there. But it seemed to me that Mario Andretti in the pit there, his eyes were calm, the eyes of a man who's done it before. There was no shot of excitement. And here's our leader coming in.
Bobby Rahal, he rolls down toward the pits now as the team is ready for him. And again, control of the race goes away from the driver. We go to Bruce Jenner.
Well, Paul, Bobby Rahal comes into the pit, and again, it seems to be just a standard change of the tires and the fuel. Nothing seems to be going wrong with the car. As I talked to Steve Horn before this pit stop, he says they have had absolutely no problem with the car. Everything's going exactly the way it should, as he just about stalled the engine going out. But overall, it's a very quick stop for the True Sports team.
Except for that minor hesitation right at the end there, that is exactly what it's supposed to be. You noticed how calm Bobby Rahal was in the cockpit, looking over to his scores, getting an affirmation that everything is okay.
Just a little more eye movement, however, than Mario. You saw the eyes blinking a little faster than Andretti. That's only age and experience and maturity that takes that calmness. It's never easy to do. The pulse rate is high, the blood pressure is effective, the adrenaline is flowing.
And as we're able to see here today, while racing externally, from the viewers, the fans' point of view, from the grandstand, is action and speed. From the driver's point of view, it is to remain calm, to work the car so carefully, to love it around the circuit, to be gentle with it.
Well, the driver who's in too much of a hurry forgets things. It's a little bit like a juggler on a stormy day. It's difficult to catch the balls as they come down in your hand and put them up exactly where you want them. The good driver is the calm driver. All the great drivers in the history of motorsport have been smooth, calculated drivers that use finesse. You see that in a driver when he does have time. Mario Andretti is at this stage in his career now. He doesn't have to win races every time. He wants to, but it's at no cost.
Mario Andretti, we watch him now. He made his stop. He came back out to fall in fourth position just behind Emerson Fittipaldi. And look at Mario Prime, the two-time world champion. A battle between world champions here. Fittipaldi is third. Andretti trying to challenge.
Well, that was a little bit of an effort there. I thought Mario was going to lock up and kiss the barrier on the left-hand side. I don't think, in fact, Emerson could have seen him properly, because he closed the door just a little too abruptly in that particular instant. And, of course, Mario's quite an impetuous driver from time to time. He's not patient about things like that. He lost time there by accelerating just a bit too briskly. You saw the back end kicking out. That's the sort of thing that when you're driving hard and you've just left the pit, sometimes it takes a little minute to get your timing back in. But he'll pass. He'll pass for the Fittipaldi, you see.
So Mario Andretti trying to challenge Fittipaldi for third place. The challenge is on now. They have the slower car of Dick Simon just ahead. And Mario is excellent at using the slower traffic, as now he tries inside Fittipaldi as Fittipaldi breaks off and goes for the pits. Andretti picks up third place. Here's Michael Andretti in the pits. Let's go to Gary Gerrell.
Michael Andretti in the pits. 9 seconds, 10. There's flame back underneath the rear wing from the exhaust. The fueling is complete. Water bottle over. They had problems on that first stop on the left rear. Now there's a problem on the right rear. It's been problems on both sides of the rear of the car on both pit stops. This could be a devastating blow for young Michael Andretti, who has battled so diligently to get back in the hunt. But his opportunity to win this event now, really looking grim. Steady stream of water back on that rear wing that was flaming momentarily. Problem now, they get the right rear off. Finally, they look back over the wall. We don't know what the problem is for sure. They're looking for more equipment, but this is a long, long stop for Michael Andretti. And the disappointment, the frustration, so very, very evident to the man who led the national championship standings coming in.
Frustration in the eyes of the 24-year-old Michael Andretti. He's crashed here. He's performed well. He's been on the pole, but he's never won. Now he is conscious of the fact that every second he sits, he falls further back in the field. Now already falling back to fifth place. And as cars stream past, he goes further and further back as they work desperately at that right rear of the car, working on the right rear, trying to get that machine back into the action.
Well, it could be that the nut has stripped. It seems that something serious has occurred in any case. But the end of the race for him, as far as being in contention for the lead is concerned, he can't win the race in this condition now. He's just got to try and catch up as many places as he can. Terribly disappointing, but those are the things that happen when everybody is under pressure. Everyone in this team, including the drivers, under pressure. A mechanic gets the thread a little bit wrong putting it on, and that's the end of the picture.
Michael Andretti rolls out of the pits. As he does so, Tom Sneva takes sixth place away from him, and Michael Andretti drops back to seventh. The leader is Bobby Rahal as he moves past Derek Daly in the Rainer car, and we'll be back with more from the Meadowlands after this. Back in New Jersey as Chevrolet presents the Meadowlands Indy, and Bobby Rahal is our leader. Second place, Mario Andretti, followed by Fittipaldi, Brabham, and Ari Leyendijk. We're under yellow right now, and the reason for the yellow is an accident involving Ludwig Heimrath. The car closest to the screen, the number 23 car, came out, smacked the wall, damaged the left side of the car. Now, fortunately, Ludwig Heimrath Jr. was not injured in this accident, but the car obviously damaged and cannot continue. So Ludwig Heimrath, starting this race as a rookie and following in his father's footsteps, the great Trans Am driver, out of this race early. In this vehicle, Rick Mears, who while driving on the course had a rock hit him in the helmet, come through the helmet visor, and apparently hit him in the side of the face by the eye, but he is reported to be okay. And Danny Sullivan, defending champion, out of the race. Let's go to Bruce Jenner. Danny, what happened out there?
Well, we were having a pretty good race, and Kevin Cogan got all sideways up in the real narrow bit up in the bridge and spun it. And I was right behind him, had nowhere to go, and I went up high and got on the marbles and hit the outside fence, and it damaged the car too bad to continue.
Seems like it was frustrating up to that point. You are the defending champion in this race, but your car didn't seem to be quite in the money today.
No, but I tell you, I was more pleased than it appeared. We were using less RPM. We had the engine leaned out, and we were using 2.5 inches less boost, and I figured if I could stay there and be at the end, we'd have a chance.
But not today.
Not today.
Cleveland.
So Danny Sullivan joins this list of cars out of the race. Also, Roberto Guerrero, you will notice, out of the race as well. And he really wasn't a factor after the first few laps. Rick Mears struck in the eye but reported okay by a rock. And Kevin Cogan in that confrontation with Danny Sullivan is back running in 12th place. Let's go to Gary Gerrell.
Well, here is the culprit. This is the little devil that knocked Michael Andretti virtually out of contention for any victory here. It seized on the right rear hub. It just couldn't get it off. It made that abnormally long pit stop. The clock tells the story. It was a minute and 34 seconds in the pits. That's well over a lap and a half. It really cost him any chance for victory.
Well, while it may have cost him a chance for victory, he is currently running in seventh place, and this full course yellow flag has helped close up the front of the field. That's Tom Sneva just ahead, and Ari Leyendijk should be in fifth place just ahead of Tom. So Michael does have a chance to run at it as we wait for the green flag to come out again after our second full course yellow. It is green. Bobby Rahal leads them to the flag, followed by Mario, followed by Emerson Fittipaldi. Several cars at the back of the field, and then Jeff Brabham, Ari Leyendijk, Tom Sneva, and Michael Andretti as Mario tries desperately to come inside of Bobby Rahal. Can't get it done. Rahal holds him off.
Well, it did seem that Mario got very wide there. It almost left his braking too late, it would seem. But Mario Andretti is in the right place to attack now. Keep in mind that the drivers have to get into their rhythm again, have to get timing. This is the kind of moment that Mario Andretti could be very cheeky with Bobby Rahal.
They are both very, very good. And now with less than a quarter of the race to go, Mario Andretti tries to catch Bobby Rahal. Emerson Fittipaldi is back just a bit, about 3 seconds behind this fight right now. And just behind Emerson is Jeff Brabham, that Honda-powered machine, as he's trying to catch Fittipaldi. So with the flag closing everything up, as we watch Fittipaldi and Brabham, the flag, the yellow flag, full course yellow, closed the front of this field again and turned it back into one very hot race. While Rahal really had the advantage of pulling away for a bit there, now he is back having to hold his position against Mario Andretti.
Bobby Rahal just getting a little bit of breathing space there. Just a few car lengths make all the difference. When you do look in a rear view mirror of a single-seater race car and it's totally filled by another car, it is, to say the least, off-putting. You have to keep a very cool nerve when it comes to that. Bobby Rahal just a breath ahead. This is still overtaking opportunity for Andretti. It needs to be that each driver has to transmit that power more positively, more carefully. The last time they went round that particular corner, Mario got a little over-exuberant, got a little too much power on the road. The tire marks that you saw right there, one of them was from his car.
Well, the fight is for the lead. The battle between Brabham and Fittipaldi for third, breaking off for the second. Look at Bobby Rahal, the professorial look at the history major from Denison University, as he now begins to pull out the lead and pull away from Mario Andretti. He was a half a second ahead of Andretti at the line before. He is now almost a full second and a half. So Mario Andretti is not in a position to catch Bobby Rahal. And Bobby Rahal, who thought he had this race won at about this point last year, appears to be in exactly the same position. Last year, the race, of course, taken away by Danny Sullivan.
No motor race is over until the checkered flag is dropped. And we've seen this happen a few times. So don't go anywhere. This race in the Meadowlands could still change dramatically. Keep in mind, it was a very tight racetrack, 1.682 miles around for each lap. It's a 100-lap race in total. But it's very tiring, and if a driver just loses the mildest amount of concentration, he'll kiss one of those barriers, it'll break a wheel, bend a suspension unit, and just anything can happen.
Mario Andretti now 1.1 seconds behind the leader, Bobby Rahal, as we look at the Tribune appearance of Mario Andretti, almost a Roman appearance. He, of course, born in Italy, now lives in Nazareth, Pennsylvania, and they'll be bringing a race to his hometown, the new Penske track at Nazareth, scheduled early in September into the kart series now, a new venue there. As we have the clock now running on Bobby Rahal, and we have an opportunity here, Jackie Stewart, for an interesting comparison. We're looking at two different kinds of power. The Cosworth power, the long-established and engine totally and fully developed in Bobby Rahal's car, and the brand-new Ilmor Chevrolet. Not a stock Chevrolet, but a true racing engine in Mario's car.
Well, in fact, Ilmor was with Cosworth Engineering, and it was the Ford Cosworth that started its life in Grand Prix motor racing and then was adapted to Indy racing. It does seem that at the moment, he's just stretched his read out considerably. Still looking at that lap time as he goes around there. Let's have a look and see how he does it as he steadily draws away, because I think this engine seems to be pulling well in all areas of the rev range. That seems to be one of the characteristics of the Cosworth. And any new engine coming in for the first time, it's not easy for them to get it right.
There it is. Bobby Rahal comes around in a minute and two, and he's averaging right at 98 miles an hour. The average speed of the race to this point at 84, but he is running running well up above that now. He has run the fastest lap in the race at 96.67 miles an hour. So obviously, Bobby Rahal is very, very quick. And he is leading here at the Meadowlands, followed by Mario Andretti, Emerson Fittipaldi, Jeff Brabham, and Ari Lyon-Dyke. We'll be back. We're back at the Meadowlands with nine laps to go. Bobby Rahal is the leader. You see the five car of Mario Andretti in pursuit. He runs in second place, 9/10 of a second behind the leader. Emerson Fittipaldi currently runs in third. Allanzer Jr., by the way, has dropped well back in the field. He stalled on the course, had to get towed to get restarted, and little Al now runs in eighth place. But you're watching the leader, Bobby Rahal, the defending PPG IndyCar champion, as he works his way around this circuit, being chased by Mario Andretti.
Mario was a man I expected to be able to take this race. In fact, that Bobby Rahal has driven a masterful race, very well-judged race, a race I would be proud of, because he certainly hasn't appeared to be rushing into anything. Mario, from time to time, would have seemed to be the more aggressive driver. The race isn't over yet. Mario can still do it, but it does seem that Rahal can take an advantage when he needs it.
Bobby Rahal is running the fastest laps of this race. He's now averaging over 97 miles an hour. That last lap at 97.46 miles an hour, and he has just under eight laps to go. So Mario Andretti's time is running out, and it does not appear that he is capable of catching Rahal. But as you have said so many times, Jackie Stewart, anything could happen. Here is Michael Andretti, currently in sixth place on the scoring. That's Emerson Fittipaldi just ahead of him. So he is closing in now, and Fittipaldi is... We've got a change in positions here as Lyon-Dyke moves alongside Fittipaldi. That's a battle for third place right now, and it's a three-way fight. In fact, Jeff Brabham is there as well. So Fittipaldi at this moment holding on to third, but Brabham is there in the 15 car. Lyon-Dyke is there in the 71 car, and of course, Michael Andretti right in the midst of that fight as well.
Well, Mario Andretti, of course, is down a lap because of the problem that he had in the pits, the very long pit stop he had.
Ari Lyon-Dyke, car 71, sitting just ahead of Michael Andretti. He had that long pit stop, and so while he's physically in here, he is running in sixth place behind Lyon-Dyke. And Ari Lyon-Dyke, his best finish so far in his career has been third. He's looking for at least a third again, and he fights with Michael Andretti now, the leader again, Bobby Rahal. Mario Andretti in second place with seven laps to go.
Michael getting very close. You can see the question of where he must be able to overtake. You can still make mistakes by running into the back of another car in a situation like this. It's very easy to do. You can take both of them out.
So Michael Andretti fights with Ari Lyon-Dyke, gets past, and Michael Andretti charges up. Look at Jeff Brabham, the 15 car as well. Now Michael must move up in the traffic. He is trying to get as many points as he can. He came into this race as the points leader. But if Bobby Rahal goes on to the checkered flag, he will score 21 points here, taking him ahead to 74, and Michael will lose his lead in the points fight. So it's very important for Michael to move up if he can.
Oh, well, the World Championship or the Kart Championship, any championship, you've got to think of collecting points, particularly when you've had a problem like he had in the pits. It's now a question of him collecting points. He has no chance of winning the race under normal conditions, so therefore he's got to be running for the points.
So Michael Andretti, chasing position, a lap off of the pace. Jeff Brabham, while he is in this fight, remember, is a full lap ahead of Michael. Michael is running off of the pace right now. Those on the leader lap are, of course, our leader, Bobby Rahal. Mario Andretti in second. Emerson Fittipaldi in third. And Jeff Brabham running in fourth place. And that's the fourth place car of Jeff Brabham. You saw the trail of smoke behind him as he moves past Lyon-Dyke. It is not a move for position, of course, though. Lyon-Dyke is well behind Brabham, actually lying in sixth place right now. The leader still, Bobby Rahal, averaging over 96 miles an hour, which is an awesome speed on this very tight course. 31 feet wide at its narrowest, only 50 feet wide at its widest portion. Bobby Rahal trying to notch his first victory at the Meadowlands. And by the way, this would be his second straight win. He won 2 weeks ago at Portland. We mentioned that Rick Mears was hit in the helmet by a rock, and it got into the helmet visor. He is still at the track hospital, but the reports from the kart officials are that he is okay. Let's go to the pits now. Gary Gerrell.
Paul, you talk
about Mario Andretti and, of course, the fact that he's been such a dominant force all season long, the brain trust for this team, and it's really an all-star team of talent. In the hat, closest to the camera on the headset is Tyler Alexander, the team manager, his back virtually to the camera. To his left, Adrian Newey, who's acknowledged as perhaps the finest aerodynamics expert and engineer in this business right now. Between them, they're constantly plotting, planning. These are the guys who really call the shots for Mario Andretti and that have helped make him be so successful thus far this season. Paul?
Just over three laps to go as Debbie Rahal watches from her husband's scoring stand. She keeps track of the race and hopes that in the next few moments, Bobby Rahal will see the checkered flag first. It certainly appears that way, but Mario Andretti just a bit over 3 seconds behind Bobby Rahal. Andretti was a challenge a few moments ago, but as you see, Rahal averaging over 97 miles an hour now in these last few laps is pulling away from Mario Andretti.
I wonder if Mario is being careful with fuel now, because this was a borderline racetrack with regards to fuel consumption. And it just comes into my mind that Mario's allowed Rahal just to get a little bit far away. That may be that Mario has decided that there's not enough fuel in there to do the full race at full speed. So it could be that he's stroking it just a wee bit.
Debbie Rahal hopes that her husband will come home the winner. He did it 2 weeks ago. Can he do it here at the Meadowlands? He was in fine shape 1 year ago until Danny Sullivan took the race away from him. Mario Andretti would like to, but it does not appear likely that that will occur. By the way, the Meadowlands race will continue with a multi-year agreement promoted by John Frasco and Pat Patrick. There was some question of its future, but they have decided the Meadowlands event will indeed go on as 98 laps are now complete. Nick Fenoro reaches down at the starter stand, picks up the white flag. Mario Andretti's crew watches on. Bobby Rahal brings it through the third turn. There is Andretti. You can see the interval. Not truly close, but still, anything can happen in these final laps. Rahal, like all of the cars, very close on fuel toward the end of the race. Here is Bobby Rahal. He is making his turn through five. As we watch now, the white flag should be coming out this lap. Let's go to Rahal's pits and Bruce Jenner.
Well, Paul, the most difficult thing for any team member is to watch their driver out there, especially when they're in the lead. There are only a couple of laps to go, Debbie Rahal, and probably this is the toughest time for anybody.
I think this is especially difficult right now because we had an 18-second lead before the yellow. And, you know, right now we're all feeling, well, excited because we're so close, making for a good race.
All right, well, good luck to you.
Thanks very much.
Paul. Bobby Rahal screams past the pits. The white flag flies. One more lap to go. Just about a mile and a half now for Bobby Rahal. Will he make it two in a row? Will he improve his point standing? The best ever, even as we speak. But it will get much better here in just a few moments if only he can hold on for this one final lap.
Well, I take my hat off to him. I think he's been smooth. I think he's been careful. I think his crew have done a great job. I think he has driven with precision. The type of race around a tricky and difficult track such as this that takes a very talented driver. And I think his road racing experience and reputation will rise because of today's performance. None of the key players apart from Guerrero has really dropped out.
Well, Bobby Rahal now with no challenge. Mario Andretti came across the line 4.5 seconds back. Emerson Fittipaldi was 33 seconds back in third place. Jeff Brabham was fourth as he acknowledged the white flag. Bobby Rahal runs all alone on the circuit. And we look now for the checkered flag as Bobby Rahal heads for the pit line. And Bobby Rahal sees the twin checkered flags. Bobby Rahal has won the fourth run at the Meadowlands. Bobby Rahal the winner. Mario Andretti comes to the line running in second place. The interval of victory, 3.8 seconds. Mario Andretti coming in second. Emerson Fittipaldi unofficially in third. Jeff Brabham in fourth place. But Bobby Rahal has won.
Well, there's a man who must feel very pleased with himself. I thought his wife was very calm when she was interviewed. A very calm lady and obviously a very calm driver.
So Bobby Rahal has won here at the Meadowlands, and we'll be back to talk with him right after these messages. This from his gorgeous wife, Debbie. Bobby Rahal, the winner here at the Meadowlands. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Well, here we are down here, Paul. A cool drink of water, and it's well-deserved. Bobby pulls the earplugs out. How do those hands feel? You get no chance to rest them today.
Well, I'll tell you, I was determined to treat this as an all-out sprint from the word go, and when we had 18 seconds lead there, it was looking good, and then and threw that yellow for, I guess, various reasons, and that really made me work, because Mario was, I knew he was going to come after me, and fortunately our car was working great. The Bud car, the Bud crew, they did a great job on the pits for me, and when you have as good a team as this, it's easy to win.
Career win number 16, more importantly, two in a row. You move up in the championship point standings as team manager Steve Horn leans in to congratulate his driver. But the thing that intrigues me, you have been on a tremendous hot streak, not only in kart competition, but you've won four very big races this month now. What's happened?
I don't know, but I hope it keeps going, that's for sure. You know, when you're with as good a team as we're with, and IMSA with Bruce Levin, and with True Sports and IndyCar Racing, you just have a leg up, and it's just up to you to do the job you can do, and fortunately so far we're doing that.
Unofficially, he'll move within 4 or 5 points now of Michael Andretti. Cleveland next week. I imagine you're ready to get in the car and drive it right now to Cleveland.
I'm ready to win again, that's for sure. We that was the first race we won. We've come close a couple times and had some heartbreak. Hopefully we can put it together this year.
Okay, Bobby Rahal, he's very, very happy, of course, Paul.
Rahal also had the fastest lap of the race at 96.9 miles an hour. Let's go meet second place with Bruce Jenner.
Mario Andretti, it was really sort of a tough day for you. You had a lot of car, but just not quite enough there at the end.
Not quite enough. We were a little bit off on the spring race, I'm afraid, and I just couldn't run the left race tidy enough, and that's all it took.
Well, up to that point, really, the car was very good all the way through, and you really can't complain too much about it. It's a good second-place finish, some good solid points.
Well, that it is. I mean, the car just ran beautifully. We just didn't have the setup quite the way we possibly could have, but it's just one of those things.
All right, next week at Cleveland.
Okay, Bruce, thanks.
Paul? So 168 miles at the Meadowland now complete, and Bobby Rahal, who started second, finished up as the leader. Final results of the race, Rahal, Andretti, Emerson Fittipaldi third, Jeff Brabham with a nice fourth-place finish, and Michael Andretti stays in the points fight with a fifth-place finish, followed by Lion Dyke Sneva, Little Al, Derek Daly, and Scott Brayton. The points fight tightens up just a bit as Bobby Rahal now moves into the points lead ahead of Michael Andretti. Good, tough race, Jackie Stewart.
Well, a well-judged race, well-prepared team. The old Cosworth engine winning over the newer development engine that's still got a few things to do, I think.
IndyCar race.